Welcome to the Aviator and the Watchmaker. So to prepare for this, I read three books. Or maybe I should say two and a half. You'll see why, and maybe you can judge yourself. First, Louis Cartier's The Untold Story of the Family Behind the Jewelry Empire. It's written by Francesca Cartier Bricquel. She is great-granddaughter to Pierre Cartier. And so once, whilst looking for a bottle of wine at the cellar at the house, she stumbled upon a trunk full of letters from her great-grandfather and his brothers, and she was able to put together quite the story about their lives from it. It's fantastic. I was disappointed at how little literature there is out there about Alberto Santos-Dumont. I could find this children's book. The Fabulous Flying Machines of Alberto Santos-Dumont, Victoria Griffiths. It has beautiful pictures, but it didn't give me that much, so I guess that counts as half a book. But I did find the autobiography of Alberto Santos-Dumont, which he published in 1904. It's titled Airships, The Story of My Life by Alberto Santos-Dumont. And it's available for free online. I'll leave a link to that for those of you who are interested in further reading. I'd highly recommend the book. It's fantastic. I also visited the Cartier shop in town here, and they couldn't have been nicer to me. They even gave me a little gift. They're absolutely lovely. And now I'm going to share my screen so we can dive into this fabulous story. All right, now the story of Cartier first. Cartier International was started in 1847, founded by the man you see on the screen, Louis-François Cartier. He had been an apprentice to a watchmaker named Adolphe Piccard. In 1847, he bought the business with the hopes of transforming it. However, the following year there was the February Revolution of 1848, which made life difficult. People were literally eating rats to survive. And if you couldn't eat, you wouldn't be able to buy jewelry. He managed to pull through that and to grow his moderate business. What his business was that he bought and sold jewelry. He married and had a son whom he named Alfred. When Alfred was old enough, he joined his dad in business. And then in the 1870s, France was in turmoil once more. This time it was the Paris Commune, a socialist revolution targeting the elites. And so the elites wanted to flee, but they couldn't access their money at banks. And so they pawned off their jewelry. And Alfred took advantage of this and bought their jewelry at rock bottom prices. And almost overnight, he had one of the best jewelry collections in the whole of France. They left France during the Franco-Prussian War and closed everything down. But after the war, Louis Francois returned to Paris and reopened the business. And then in 1873, Alfred returned to Paris and joined his dad. His dad made him purchase the company from him for 143,000 francs, which is approximately $640,000 today. The sale contract stipulated that the business could not be sold to anyone else until he completed the payments, because he was paying in installments for it. So Alfred's dad also selected a wife for him. It was a strategic move. She came from money, and he knew that she would bring a substantial dowry to the marriage. So the families negotiated, and Alfred married Alice Griffey. A year later, their son, Louis Joseph Cartier, was born on the 6th of June, 1875. Business wasn't doing well at the time because the wealthy women preferred couture to jewels. And so Cartier approached the most famous fashion maison in Paris at the time. Before Yves Saint Laurent, Dior, and Chanel, there was Charles Frederick Worth. He is known as the father of haute couture. He's the first internationally renowned fashion designer in the world, and also the man who basically created the luxury industry. He was British. Now, a princess had worn one of his creations to an event, and all the other royal women were so impressed. They began to swarm his shop. Royal women from all over the world would come to his boutique. And so Alfred Cartier approached him to ask if he could display some of his jewelry at the Worth's shop showroom windows in return for a commission. These are the Cartier boys with their dad. They're quite a close-knit family. So this is what the Worth boutique looked like. Anyway, so Worth agreed, and that is how Cartier began its ascent to becoming jeweler to kings. Louis was a toddler by this time, and the family was thriving. He grew up with servants, and by all accounts, was a very naughty child. His parents had two other sons and a daughter after Louis. So Louis and his brothers, Pierre and Jacques, will take Cartier to undreamed of heights. In 1887, the powers that be decided to sell the crown jewels of France at an auction. They felt that since France was a democracy, they needed to get rid of all the symbols of monarchy. The rationale was, without a crown, no need for a king. And also, it would, prevent any coup d'etat attempts, those who were longing for the monarchy again. All the big jewelry houses like Boucheron, Tiffany, Boudier, and Bacht, and others were amongst the bidders at the auction. But Cartier was too small and relatively poor at this time to participate. The Cartier kids were very close to each other growing up. Louis was extremely intelligent, creative, stubborn, extraordinarily imaginative, and seen as a daydreamer by his teachers. They would complain that he always had his head in the clouds. Their father regularly took kids to fairs, and Louis fell in love with the new inventions at machines at many of these fairs. So it was at one such fair that he would meet his future wife. He just didn't know it yet. He was 14 and she was 8. Her name was Andrée Caroline, and she was the granddaughter of Charles Worth, the designer. That's her. Now, she had modeled one of her grandpa's creations at the fair, and right then, Alfred Cartier immediately started the wheels turning in his head that he was going to ensure that one of his sons married her because it would be great for business. The Cartier kids, their dad and their grandpa were all very invested in making sure their business succeeded. And even at that young age, they were all determined to make their family business the best in the world. It's something that even as children, they would tell each other, remember that we're going to create the best luxury jewelry brand in the world. Yes, they had aristocrats and royals as clients, but these boys had bigger plans for their company. In March 1867, a farmer's son had picked up a particularly shiny stone along the riverbanks of the Orange River in South Africa. That stone is known as the Eureka Diamond. And its discovery would upend the jewelry industry. Diamonds had been very rare and found in small quantities in India and Brazil, and now suddenly there was an endless supply of them in Africa. The De Beers mine rushed in and set up shop there. Now that diamonds could be readily available and affordable, everybody wanted them. Bankers, industrialists, speculators, you name it. This period became known as the Belle Epoque, when several American heiresses married into Europe's aristocratic families and brought their wealth with them. And then suddenly everybody and their grandmother wanted a tiara. On April 30th, 1898, when Louis was 23 years old, he did marry Andre Caroline, just as his dad had planned. Louis desperately wanted out of it, but his father pressured him to marry her. The creme de la creme of French society came to witness the merger of these two great families. It really was a business merger. The day before the wedding, Louis had desperately begged to get out of it. His father grabbed his arm and forcefully explained to him that the future of the family and the business rested on this union. On a good day, the Cartiers would not have been able to marry a woman from the Worth family. Her family was way, way high up above theirs. They were only able to marry a Worth because she was severely mentally ill. And also, she had been born out of wedlock. And so, none of the aristocratic men that she could have married wanted anything to do with her, the poor girl. So, I hate saying this, but the Cartiers got her cheaply. So, the day of the wedding, Louis wasn't very happy standing at the altar waiting for her to arrive. But in marrying a Louis was actually doing her family a favor and his family too by extension. At first, he had been excited about her and would regularly praise her beauty. But then he spent time with her, and that's when he and his brothers noticed just how unwell she was. He only went ahead with the marriage because his father promised to let him divorce her after 10 years, by which time their family would have benefited from the union. At the wedding ceremony, after she walked up the aisle and he lifted her veil, he almost lost his nerve. Her eyes were totally vacant, as if she wasn't there at all. It even startled his brother, who was standing next to him. If that wedding had happened today, it would be illegal because she couldn't be considered as someone who could have consented to it. She seemed unconscious. It's like he was marrying an empty shell. So the newspapers didn't know any of this, of course, and they breathlessly gushed about her. The Cartiers were still relatively unknown, and so the Cartier family was barely even mentioned in the news articles about the wedding. Even the groom barely got mentioned. The merger was very advantageous to the Cartier family because, first of all, they received a dowry that is the equivalent of $4 million today from her family. In addition to access to the top-notch international clientele of the Worth family business. When J.P. Morgan heard about the marriage, he visited Louis, promised him his future patronage, and bought $50,000 worth of jewels on the spot. So, with all this money flowing in, the Cartier business moved into a bigger premises at number 13 Rue des Paix. They had 13 salesmen, 13 workshop operators, and 13 helpers. And so number 13 became the lucky number for the Cartier company. There is no doubt that this marriage was advantageous to the Cartier family. It was great for business. However, on a personal level, it was an unmitigated disaster. André was erratic and unstable. Louis was impatient and miserable. He also had an explosive temper. Never a good combination. And he was so desperately unhappy that he avoided being home with her as far as possible. During the daytime, he focused on his work. And at night, he went out to clubs and to restaurants. He began working on the Cartier signature style because he believed that the only way the family business would stand the test of time was to create its own jewels that were unique and recognizably Cartier. He thought all the jewelry around at the time was boring. And so he assembled his own team of inventors. They were experts in many fields: lace making, bronze sculptors, tapestry designers, architects, and iron workers. He also hired the first woman to ever work there, a pearl stringer, a decision that greatly angered his dad. Alfred exploded on Louis when he found out that there was a woman working there, and Louis, who was still angry about the marriage, blew up right back at his dad. And so Alfred gave in. Louis experimented with different metals. And he loved using platinum. And at that time, platinum was not yet considered a precious metal. And so he would play with it. And ultimately, the Cartier style emerged and was predominantly 18th century inspired and had a mix of platinum and diamond pieces. They also made lots of tiaras. And so naturally, this attracted royals, aristocrats, and heiresses. At that time, the elite women wore tiaras almost daily as they went to various soirees and opera events. And they invited Louis to these events, so he became ensconced in that crowd. A nightclub known as Maxim's became his second office. It was always filled with beautiful women, many of whom were courtesans. And naturally, these women drew the wealthy men over to the club. And as Louis mixed with them, he soon realized that with every man he met at Maxim's, he had two opportunities for a sale. Almost every man would want a diamond necklace for his mistress, and then perhaps out of guilt, a tiara for his wife. And also, the women were competing with each other because the more jewels you wore, the more wealthy lovers you had. And this was great for the Cartier business. It was impossible for Louis to be at Maxim's on any given night and not see at least one of his pieces on any of the women present. Some of you might have heard about the famous Spanish courtesan La Belle Otero. She took the world by storm in her day. She had many wealthy lovers, and she was often seen there wearing Cartier from head to toe. And so it was at this club that it is speculated that he met his friend, the Brazilian father of aviation, Alberto Santos-Dumont. When last did someone achieve something that made you want to dance in the streets? Have you ever done something that made people so proud of you they dance in the streets? Let me introduce you to Alberto Santos-Dumont.
He showed the world how to fly anytime, anywhere, before anyone had even heard of the Wright brothers. In balloons, dirigibles, and finally, an airplane.
He was the most famous person in his time. I mean, the English papers said that when people looked back at the turn of the century, years from then, they would remember only one name, Alberto Santos-Dumont.
In many quarters, he was seen as far superior to the Wrights, indeed as the inventor of flight.
He was that legendary figure, 5'4", something like that, but larger than life at the same time, who just reached out and grabbed the public imagination by the lapels.
For Santos, flight wasn't just about lift, airflow, and engines. Flying was his theology, based on a belief that flight would unite the world, helping to end war and discord. Sadly, Santos's incredibly colorful and hopeful life would end in tragedy, his name largely forgotten. Yet when modern flight was born little more than a century ago, it was Santos who carried the world aloft on his frail and troubled shoulders.
Alberto Santos-Dumont. I like to think of him as Brazil's Nikola Tesla. He was born on a coffee plantation in 1873. It was in São Paulo in Brazil. He had always been fascinated with machines. At age seven, he already learned how to drive a train. His dad had French ancestry. His father was a very rich man who owned the most mechanized plantation in the world at the time. From the moment the coffee berries arrived on the railway trains until the moment the coffee products were loaded onto transatlantic ships, no human hands touched them. Everything was mechanized, and this was in the 1800s. So naturally, Santos was passionate about mechanics. Even as a child of 10, he was convinced that man would fly during his lifetime. He played with the machines and tinkered with them all day long. He learned how to repair them. He read all of Jules Verne's books before he was 10 years old. That's Jules Verne. He is the man who wrote Around the World in 80 Days and Journey to the Center of the Earth. And he's regarded as the father of science fiction. As a child, Santos would play with the other ch children, and they used to play a game known as Pigeon Flies. Now, the objective of the game was to call out the names of things that could fly. And when this was done, you were to raise your hand up. And if they call out the names of something that didn't fly, then you shouldn't raise your hand. And if you did, then you were made to pay a forfeit or kicked out of the game if you refused to. And so, for instance, they would say, hen flies. Anybody would raise their hands. Pigeon flies. Everybody would raise up their hands. Crow flies. Everyone would raise up their hands. And then they'd say things like table flies. And no one would raise their hands. Dog flies. And no one would raise up their hands. But young Santos always lost this game. Because each time they said, man flies, he would raise his hand. And then they tried to make him pay the forfeit and he'd refuse to pay it. And then they'd kick him out of the game. He knew it in his soul. It was an absolute conviction to him that mankind would fly in his lifetime. You know, of the thousands of letters he received when he had achieved his dream, one that stood out to him came from one of the boys he had played with, and I'm going to read it to you. Quote, "Do you remember the time, my dear Alberto, when we played Pigeon Flies? It all came back to me suddenly the other day when the news of your success reached Rio. Man flies, old fellow. You were right to raise your hand, and you have just proved it by flying around the Eiffel Tower. You were right not to pay the forfeit. Bravo. You deserve the 100,000 franc prize. We should have paid you the forfeit." They still play that old game now more than ever at home. But the name has been changed and the rules modified. Since October 19th, 1901, they call it Man Flies. And anyone who doesn't raise their hands pays the forfeit. Your friend Pedro. The letter took him back to the happiest days of his childhood when he would build light airplanes out of straw as well as silk paper balloons and watch in ecstasy as they ascended to the skies above. He saw his first balloon in 1888 when he was 15 years old. There was a balloon craze back then, thanks to a man named Montgolfier. So, in his heart, Santos had an admiring worship for that man. Santos would spend hours lying down on the veranda at home, staring up at the sky and watching how effortlessly the birds were flying up there. He fell in love with the space and the freedom. In his imagination, he was already building his airships and his flying machines. But he could not dare to tell anyone about his dream because they would have thought he was crazy and they could have locked him up. He couldn't talk about it, especially because he belonged to a prominent family. In 1891, his family traveled to Paris and he was overjoyed because he thought he was going to see steerable balloons and cars for the first time. He got to Paris and he was astonished to discover that steerable balloons had not been invented yet. He schooled in Paris. He studied engineering, physics, chemistry, electricity, and mechanics. He was somehow able to finagle a meeting with an aeronaut in Paris, and he told the man about his vision. He also asked the man if he would take him on a short balloon ride, and the man told him that it would cost 12,000 francs. At this time, Santos was only 18 years old, and he didn't know how he could justify using that much money for a short ascent to his parents, and so he decided against it. He instead turned his attention to cars. They were still a novelty at the time, and so he bought himself a car. At that time, there were no driver's licenses, no mechanics. Also, large crowds gathered around to look at cars, and so he was always driving at his own risk, and he avoided certain parts of town to avoid getting swarmed. He studied all the parts of his car and learned how to care for it and to repair it by himself. He tried to approach a few other aeronauts, but he found them very closed off. It was a little club and they kept everyone else out. And so his frustrations led him to turn to automobile tricycle racing to satisfy his need for speed. But he decided that he was going to build his own flying machine, and he found a book that taught him how to build one and equip it. And it would only cost him 40,000 francs. He even met the man who had written the book and asked the man if he would take him on a balloon ride. The man was Macheron. Well, Macheron agreed to take him for a 3 or 4 hour balloon ride. And guess how much it cost? 250 francs. And that is how Alberto Santos-Dumont got to experience his first taste of flying. He went up so high, he was looking down at the clouds. He packed them a lunch of hard-boiled eggs, cold roast beef and chicken, cheese, ice cream, fruit, cakes, champagne, coffee, and chartreuse. Everything tasted better up there. After that, he was hooked on flying. He even had his first balloon built, and he named it the Brazil. Well, he went on 30 other balloon rides before he ever took the Brazil out up there. So he'd go on numerous solo flights, and oftentimes he'd rent one of the bigger balloons, and he would invite as many as four guests with him, and they go up in the balloons together. Flying still scared him every single time, but he kept on going. And sometimes while up there, a storm would develop, and to his amazement, it didn't scare him at all. He knew it was dangerous. He heard the thunder and he saw the lightning, but he felt as if he was a part of the storm. And so rather than fear, he felt a fierce joy. He particularly enjoyed flying at night in the black void, and he came to see flying as a spiritual experience. It was an adventure, and he was an explorer, just like the characters in those books he read in his childhood. But he was still at the mercy of the winds, and so he decided that he wanted flights that could be controlled despite the winds. And he took a picture. This is a picture of some of the crowds that came to see him when he went up flying. People were so fascinated with it, and with good reason too. He'd made quite a name for himself. And after successful flights, Santos would go over to Maxim's to celebrate with the jubilant crowds. He loved taking pictures and sharing pictures that he took from up there. Like that picture of Paris from above. He learned from his mistakes and corrected them and helped to improve other machines that he was building. So it was Alberto's dream for everybody to own their own personal airships and to travel around town running errands in them. In fact, Santos himself was often seen traveling from restaurants to clubs around Paris in his airships. He would park them outside on the street, tied to a lamp post, and then he'd pop in for a glass of champagne and then just go back and fly home. Louis and Santos were both members of the prestigious Blue-Blooded Aero Club of France, and Santos was one of the co-founders, along with his childhood hero, Jules Verne. He was a daredevil and a socialite, and he also used to host these fabulous dinner parties for the elites. They were hosted at the Champs-Élysées with its high ceilings, and at these events, you would rub shoulders with Rothschilds, with Vanderbilts, with Romanovs, and many of the other top people in the world. He became the toast of Paris, with fans swooning and following him everywhere. He enjoyed floating over Paris and would even race with car drivers on the ground. He ruled the skies and the people loved him. He was very warm and approachable, and so random people would walk up to him and ask him to take them up with them, and he would take them up in for balloon rides. Men dressed up like him. Newspaper editors had him followed and photographed, and he was regularly seen at Maxim's with his friend Louis Cartier. They would talk for hours about flying machines, mechanics, and other topics. He took Louis up for at least one flight, and this would serve as part of the inspiration for the Santos wristwatch. So Louis Cartier would drive out to the crowded fields to watch Santos taking off and landing in his airships. In 1900, some members of the Aero Club offered a prize to anyone who could successfully fly along a predetermined path, reach the Eiffel Tower, and then return successfully to the takeoff point. And this was supposed to all get done within 30 minutes. And whoever did it was going to win the Deutsche Prize, which was 100,000 francs. Let me share a video about Santos's attempt.
On August 8, 1901, Santos takes to the skies in airship number 5, almost 120 feet in length. Santos spent more than a year refining number 5 to capture the Deutsch Prize. Flight time to the Eiffel Tower is 9 minutes. If he keeps this pace, the Deutsch Prize will be his, easily. But his airship starts leaking hydrogen after one of the gas valves breaks. The balloon begins to deflate. Even the ballonette cannot keep the airship aloft. Santos steers for the Seine, a water landing his last best hope. But first, he must get by a Paris hotel looming dead ahead.
At the last critical moment, the end of the long balloon that was still full of gas came slapping down on the roof just before clearing it. It exploded with a great noise, exactly like a paper bag struck after being blown up.
Fortunately, Santos is unhurt, but he hangs precariously from his basket 40 feet up in the air. Then, as hundreds of admirers watch, Santos clambers to safety on a rope.
I think that anybody who ever contemplates the technology of flight and how it developed in the early days is really struck when we take a look at these early aircraft at the fact that they blended not only creativity but a tremendous amount of personal courage to actually develop a vehicle and to put an engine in it, and to realize that you would be simply detaching yourself from the Earth's surface and flying through it at potentially great personal risk.
That same day, Rob orders a new airship. He would call it Number 6. His new airship underway, Santos finds time to host one of his signature social events.
Pigeon!
The aerial dinner party. A sumptuous feast served on tables and chairs elevated 7 feet in the air. It is a party as unique as the man who gives it. His guests are often celebrities and royalty, and they love the uplifting experience of dining in the sky. October 19th, 1901, just 2 months after his terrible crash, Santos confounds everyone by taking to the air in his new ship, Number 6. As Santos approaches the Eiffel Tower, thousands of Parisians gather. And when the timekeeper announces that Santos and Number 6 have set a mid-flight record of 8 minutes and 45 seconds, people literally dance in celebration.
He went around the very tip of the Eiffel Tower in front of the largest crowd that had ever assembled in the world before, and he demonstrated that this thing that scientists said was impossible flight, that it really was possible.
But he hasn't made it yet, not even close. Santos still has halfway to go. And it's the hard part, fighting a stiff headwind the whole way. Just beyond the Eiffel Tower, his engine suddenly stalls. Santos manages to get it restarted, but loses critical time in the process. Still, he is in the home stretch.
There was one vast clamor. I said to myself that this must be a good sign. But I had no watch and really could not tell anything about it.
Overshooting the finish line, Number 6 officially clocks 29 minutes, 15 seconds. But unfortunately, another minute and 25 seconds passes before the craft is fully secured. This causes the Aero Club to rule that Santos has gone 40 seconds over the 30-minute limit, losing the Deutsch Prize.
Messieurs, bonjour. J'ai cru comprendre que je n'étais plus le gagnant de votre prix, n'est-ce pas?
Angry, Santos meets with the Aero Club and offers to do it all over.
Mais sachez-le, vous ne m'empêcherez pas de continuer.
Under immense public pressure, the committee votes to award Santos the Deutsch Prize. At 28, Santos has realized the dream of flight.
What he demonstrated with that, truly, was that the era of the practical airship that could make repetitive flights out and back, where you could take off and have some confidence that you could return to the point from which you started, I think he really demonstrated that the practical airship had arrived.
Santos's historic flight around the Eiffel Tower inspires and challenges aviators everywhere.
Santos-Dumont, because of his aerial antics, because he drew crowds, drew a whole new generation to aeronautics. They were inspired by his example, that he was brave enough to do this, that it looked like fun. He was a mentor and an inspiration to other aviators that went into this burgeoning field.
Santos is now the 20th century's most famous aviator and inventor, and he loves it.
He invented himself as a modern celebrity. And then at the same time, you had newspapers where their owners happened to be very interested in aeronautics. And they assigned people to follow him almost on a daily basis. So the New York Herald, for example, and the Paris Herald, owned by the same person, James Bennett, would follow him and have a story every day on his exploits.
Aviation Everybody adores the young aviator. He becomes affectionately known as Le Petit Santos. He is so appealing that men across Paris model their hats and clothes after his, even copying the red ties he sports in the air.
He was that legendary figure, 5'4", something like that, but larger than life at the same time, who just reached out and grabbed the public imagination by the lapels.
For all his public display, Santos keeps his personal life extremely private. He has to.
He felt a little bit of an outcast. He was probably bisexual or gay, and this was not acceptable in a country like Brazil, let alone Paris. There were certain aspects of Parisian society, of course, accepted this, but in society as a whole didn't.
Whatever conflicts lurk beneath his flamboyant exterior, inventing airships always comes first. With his epic Eiffel Tower flight behind him, Santos sets to work on a new airship, his ninth dirigible. It realizes his personal vision of bringing flight to the masses.
I read somewhere that Santos shared this prize money with the poor in Paris after he won. So it was after this that he told his friend Louis about the challenge he was having. They were enjoying supper together at Maxim's when Santos mentioned the difficulty he'd experienced whilst competing for the Deutsche Prize. He did not want to compromise safety for speed, but it was proving difficult. In fact, during the Deutsche race, he had been unable to check the time because it was too risky and he could have crashed. Now, Cartier pocket watches were quite popular amongst the fashionable men in Paris at the time. Louis began to contemplate what he could do to help Santos. So, the first wristwatch ever made had been built in 1868 by Patek Philippe. And it was made for Countess Koskovics of Hungary. There she is. And this is what the first wristwatch looked like. Wristwatches were originally created for women, and their purpose was mostly decorative. So they had very small faces. They weren't particularly meant to be utilized for telling the time. They were beautiful jewel creations like this one. And many of them were actually more like bracelets. See that? So their purpose was to draw attention to women's dainty, delicate wrists, because wrists are considered attractive. So most of the early ones were attached to the wrist with a beautiful black silk ribbon. In fact, even Cartier had created some for their female clients. And so, to suggest that Santos wear a wristwatch would have been like asking Einstein to wear stilettos. So Louis went to the drawing board to find a solution for Santos. He knew that during the Franco-Prussian War, soldiers had attached straps to their pocket watches, like so. It was convenient on the battlefield. Another variation of a pocket watch attached to a strap. And that too. But Louis did not think that these met the elegant standards for the Cartier brand. And so he came up with a simple idea, and it changed everything. And this was how the first pilot's watch looked. The original is lost to us. It may be somewhere in Brazil. But the one he made for Santos is lost to history. So this is what it looked like. It was a bold move to create a thing that had been associated with women for men, and then to attempt to change that perception. Fortunately, Santos did not mind, and given his fame, he became a brand ambassador for men's watches, because the newspapers would print his pictures, and people would ask, what's that thing around his wrist? Santos was a global celebrity whose style was emulated everywhere. His pictures were on cigar boxes, on matchboxes, and dinner plates in many countries. He was a big deal. And Cartier knew that given his fame and the way people admired him, it would only be a matter of time before men's watches would catch on. And so Louis already started to secretly produce men's watches, but he held them off from the public. Santos loved his wristwatch and made his flights safer and easier to time. Louis did not have the technical know-how for watch movements, and so he sought the expertise of the Swiss watchmaker Edmund Jaeger. So their collaboration led to the success of the Cartier men's wristwatch, and it would enable Cartier to produce a series of exceptional watches that remain classics in the history of watchmaking. When Louis eventually released the first men's wristwatches onto the markets in 1911, he named them the Santos in honor of his friend. In the meantime, Santos kept working on his next project. I'll share a video about that.
Spring 1903, Santos unveils Balladeuse, or the Little Runabout. It is a third the size of number 6, just 35 feet long. For Santos, number 9 is for all intents and purposes an aerial car.
He would dock this small dirigible in front of his apartment in the Champs-Élysées, and then at night fly to Maxim's for dinner. He'd fly when he went shopping to go to buy clothes or provisions. I mean, nobody has done that since.
The Balladeuse becomes Santos's great trademark and shows the French that the dirigible is practical in every way. But for Santos, there was nothing left to be done with dirigibles after that.
Just as Santos had felt that balloons were a dead end, after number 9, Santos realizes that dirigibles are too subject to the vagaries of weather. They would never fulfill his dream of making flight an everyday reality. So in 1905, Santos shifts his focus, setting to work designing his first heavier-than-air ship.
Santos was unique in that he was one of the very few individuals who was able to make the transition from developing balloons and airships to developing airplanes.
His French aviation contemporaries, Louis Blériot, Ferdinand Ferber, and Henri Farman, are trying hard to develop airplanes too, but with little success.
He quickly joins the movement among French aeronautical types that's just starting to bubble along, this interest in heavier-than-air flight. These guys are learning that, in fact, some really interesting things are going on in America. Especially, ultimately, these two guys, Wilbur and Orville Wright.
At the time, few aviators know exactly what the Wrights are up to, since their flights from 1903 onwards were done in secrecy. Their secrecy has a purpose, allowing the Wrights to protect future patent rights. But as a result, many aviators doubt their claims to have flown in 1903.
For example, Ferdinand Ferber made crude copies of the Wright gliders. They basically didn't work very, very well. And so because they didn't work very, very well, there was all of a sudden this suspicion that maybe the Wrights were not what they appeared. Maybe the Wrights had not, in fact, been successful aviators. Maybe the Wrights were bluffers.
Convinced that aviation's future lays with heavier-than-air machines, Santos is ready to risk his reputation and his life on designing his own airplane.
He was nervous, though, that he wouldn't be able to catch up to these other aviators. So for the first time in his life, he started doing his work in semi-secrecy. You know, before that, it was all open. That's because he was leading the pack.
Then Santos starts a collaboration with Gabriel Voisin, a gifted 25-year-old French aeronautical engineer. Together, they create a biplane composed of box kites. It's called 14 Bis. The box kite design they employ was invented 13 years earlier by Australian scientist Lawrence Hargrave. With their slightly curved winged surfaces, Hargrave's box kites have enormous lift. This is because curved surfaces have twice the lift of flat surfaces.
Santos-Dumont is right up to the minute when he sort of borrows the idea of the box kite for the design of the wing structure of 14 Bis.
14 Bis has an odd, awkward majesty to it. From his dirigible experience, Santos has the pilot stand in a basket. Like the Wright 1903 flyer, 14 Bis has a tail-first structure, known as a canard. The canard made a plane more stable in the air and less likely to crash. Santos also designs the wings with significant up.
They had known for some time that if you put dihedral in wings, that is, if you tip the wingtips up from the center of the fuselage, you'll build some inherent lateral stability into the design.
He then proceeds to test the design in his typically creative way.
He hung the 14 Bis by an iron cable and tied it to a pole, then had it pulled by a donkey. He made several tests of the aerodynamic of the shape by using this cable. After that, he tied his airplane to the dirigible. So he did all the aerodynamic tests of the shape before he made use of an engine.
So Louis would drive out to an open field outside Paris to watch Santos's feats, where thousands of people were always gathered around. And Louis was present when Santos debuted his first airplane, the 14 Bis. So Louis Blériot showed up at the event hoping to upstage Santos. That's Louis Blériot. And by the way, he would later make history as the first man to cross the English Channel in a plane. And so he showed up to where Santos was about to have his demonstration, because he did not want Santos to take credit for inventing the airplane. So how did Santos handle this? He invited Blériot to go first and try his own plane, while Santos sat back calmly and sipped on coffee. Blériot tried repeatedly. He tried three times and he failed. In fact, by the third attempt, his invention fell apart completely. And then it was Santos's turn. He started the engine, and as the plane moved down through the field, the spectators ran after it, and then it lifted up and soared into the sky. I'll share a video about that too.
November 12, 1906, Santos waits in his 14 Bis. Louis Blériot has already tried to fly this day and failed. It's up to Santos now to claim the Aero Club prize.
There is Santos-Dumont, probably terrified at the flight controls. And so he gives it full throttle while people hold back the wings and then they let go.
With officials from the Aero Club de France looking on, Santos begins his takeoff roll. And then it happens. He is airborne. The 14 Bis travels 722 feet in 21.2 seconds and achieves a height of 15 feet.
With this airplane, he performed the first official flight in history.
Now that was an accomplishment that made the world take notice. Santos at this point was no longer merely a local figure, a figure of French provincial aviation. He was a world-class aeronaut whose accomplishments very much were seen as equivalent to the Wright brothers. And since the Wrights had not yet flown in Europe and the full extent of their work was not yet known, in many quarters he was seen as far superior to the Wrights, indeed as the inventor of flight.
Santos is now truly king of the air.
After the 14 days, everybody was so proud of Santos. You know, after he landed from that flight, the crowds lifted him up in the air. Louis was there. Santos looked at him and was pointing happily at his Cartier wristwatch because he'd use it to mark his lift-up time at 21 seconds. The next day, Santos was on every front page of every newspaper in the world. It was the first time that a plane had ever taken off with its own power. Look, I know this topic is a sore spot for some, but let me explain the significance. The Wright brothers always used a real system or a catapult to launch their machines into the air. Santos built and operated a heavier-than-air machine, which was self-propelled. It didn't need anything on the outside. It could take off independently. He deserves kudos for it, and I don't think it takes anything away from the Wright brothers. And moving on. So Louis' grandfather died in 1904, and it was a blow to their family, but they got through it. His marriage was still troubled. His wife and daughter mostly stayed at her father's castle in Switzerland, while Louis enjoyed the bachelor lifestyle back in Paris. He was quite the ladies' man. In September 1908, whilst driving on a road trip with some friends, Louis was overspeeding and he crashed his car. He killed a cyclist and he broke his own leg in three places. And 2 months later, in November of 1908, his wife filed for divorce. And the divorce was granted 6 months later. After this, Louis entered one of the most creative periods of his life. He met a balcony designer named Charles Jacquot, and he hired him so that Jacquot could incorporate the beautiful designs of his balconies into jewelry. The two men would often go to the opera together, taking their sketchbooks with them, because inspiration was everywhere. Meanwhile, Santos was still making great strides. Sometimes his flying machines caught fire up in the air, and he desperately used his hats to quench the fires, and so he was often seen buying new hats in Paris. His vision was for flying machines to lead to world peace. Santos had a really good heart. He was an idealist, and he thought that everyone was like him, and everybody thought the way he did. You know, he refused to even patent any of his over 20 airplanes and airships. He sank his entire inheritance into creating these machines, and then he just gave them to the world. A wonderful man. All right, now, I would be remiss if I did not share more about the Maison Cartier and their massive strides and their creativity. So I want to share a beautiful video. Really find it a work of art. I hope you enjoy it.
Cartier was founded in Paris in 1847 by master jeweler Louis-François Cartier. His son Alfred and grandsons Louis, Pierre and Jacques, each successively at the head of the Maison, pursued their lofty ambitions for the business. In 1899, Cartier opened its premises on Rue de la Paix, the prestigious cosmopolitan hub of a capital city which attracted famous figures from all over the world. The three brothers set out to build an empire based in Paris with its sights firmly set on abroad. In 1904, Pierre and Louis traveled to Russia, a country which fascinated them and inspired an array of creations. Before long, the imperial family and Russian aristocracy were enchanted. The English aristocracy flocked to the new Cartier boutique, which opened on New Bond Street in 1909. A few years later, the youngest brother Jacques took the reins of Cartier's British branch. He cultivated ties with figures that included some of the most remarkable Indian princes. Enchanted by Cartier's expertise and unique style, the Maharajas entrusted Cartier with dazzling gemstones to be reset in stunning pieces of jewelry in the modern style. Thus began Cartier's inspiring relationship with India, where the Maison opened an office in 1911. Pierre Cartier, Louis's younger brother, moved to America to run the New York branch in 1909. A clientele consisting of rich industrialists from the New World and the finance sector was joined by the first stars of Broadway and of silent movies, and a few decades later, by Hollywood celebrities. Extraordinary figures who discovered the spirit of excellence that has always driven the Maison. As the house's signature animal, the panther has always reigned supreme over Cartier designs. The elegant feline was used for the first time on a wristwatch, with the setting of the gems recreating the animal's fur. The panther sprung to life with the arrival of Jeanne Toussaint, who worked closely alongside Louis Cartier and was nicknamed La Panthère. Jeanne made her mark on Cartier design with her feminine elegance, independence, and free-thinking temperament. Cartier was the first jeweler to explore femininity through the metaphor of the panther. The motif soon became a key part of many Cartier designs. The bounding creature adorned powder boxes, cigarette cases, and vanity cases, to later appear on bracelets, necklaces, brooches, and other sumptuous jewelry. The panther became the object of all desires. A three-dimensional panther featured on a brooch was acquired by the Duchess of Windsor in 1948. The Duchess commissioned a second brooch the following year, featuring a platinum panther perched atop a cabochon sapphire weighing over 152 carats. She completed her collection with a fully articulated panther bracelet studded with onyx. Every rendering is a strikingly lifelike sculpture, a timeless, fearless emblem. The panther still stands as an icon of the House of Cartier. Since the end of the 19th century, Cartier has created an extravagant, unique, and precious menagerie. This fantastical menagerie defines and reflects the Maison Cartier's know-how. For the jeweler, this expression of nature represents both a technical and aesthetic challenge, as in these birds caught in full flight. An astounding array of fauna inspired by all the continents. Wild beasts are borrowed from Africa, sacred animals from Egypt, a host of dragons and chimeras from Asia. In 1968, the jeweler created for the actress Maria Felix a snake necklace made up of 2,473 diamonds mounted on platinum. A few years later, the actress also acquired a pair of snake earrings and ordered an entirely articulated crocodile necklace made up of 1,023 fancy yellow diamonds and 1,060 emeralds. Panthers, tigers, and other felines, still today the jeweler creates ever more sumptuous and majestic creatures, a staggeringly beautiful menagerie. In the 19th century, the floral motif made its appearance in the Cartier story. This theme was enhanced by the garland style, marrying the sparkle of diamonds with the lightness of platinum to fashion the most precious compositions. Exquisite petals brought to life by the Maison's jewelers. Cartier reinterprets nature thanks to its unique style and expertise. Dazzling diamond petals to be worn as bracelets, brooches, or necklaces proved irresistible to the most elite clients. Princess Margaret of England fell in love with a diamond brooch mounted on platinum, while Queen Elizabeth of England entrusted Cartier with setting a 23.60 carat diamond, the Williamson diamond, in an edelweiss brooch. As the years went on, the Cartier flowers were crafted in gold, articulated and offset the most precious of stones to perfection. just like this absolutely sublime orchidée brooch in amethyst and aquamarines with its surrealist inspiration. The orchid soon became queen in the jeweler's precious garden and appears in a number of stunning interpretations. The Cartier garden blooms with dazzling flowers, exquisite metaphors of feminine beauty. Jacques Cartier made his first journey through India in 1911. Fascinated by the richness of Indian civilization and its jewelry culture, he brought back not only spectacular precious stones from his travels, but also a wealth of inspiring creative ideas. The Cartier brothers drew on the diversity of traditional Indian precious stones and figurative motifs to create a unique fusion of East and West. At the turn of the 1920s, the Indian princes entrusted Cartier, the jeweler to kings, with their amazing collection of unmounted stones. Cartier subsequently crafted pieces of jewelry for the Maharaja of Patiala and his son in Paris, as well as the Maharaja of Nawanagar in London. The jeweler sought inspiration from the pieces worn in traditional Indian parades and infused them with a modern twist. Enamored with the splendor of Indian jewelry, Cartier alone dared to experiment with unprecedented color combinations. Reds, blues, and greens with splashes of sparkling white diamonds paired perfectly with stones carved with floral, fruit, or palmette motifs. In Paris, London, and New York, clients coveted these opulent, multicolored pieces. The Hindu necklace, commissioned in 1936 by the extravagant Daisy Fellows, is a perfect example. This flamboyant, colorful, and flexible necklace features rubies, emeralds, sapphires, and diamonds mounted on platinum. The style, known as tutti frutti, would become one of Cartier's most prominent signatures. India, its jewelry tradition, and its dazzling stones inspired Cartier to explore new heights of creativity, powerful style, and unrivaled expertise. Today, more than ever, Cartier's jewelry creations continue to be inspired by the mysteries of India. Cartier, jeweler to kings, king of jewelers. This quotation from the Prince of Wales, the future King Edward VII, attests to Cartier's ties with royal families and aristocracy worldwide from the early 20th century onwards. Cartier was awarded 15 royal patents between 1904 and 1939, becoming official supplier to the most powerful dynasties, which most notably ordered precious tiaras from the jeweler. In 1909, at the behest of Grand Duchess Vladimir, Maria Pavlovna of Russia, Cartier created a tiara adorned with sapphires and diamonds. A foliate scroll tiara created in 1910 was acquired by Elizabeth, Queen of the Belgians, in 1912, while that of Queen Victoria Eugenia of Spain was made in 1920. In 1926, Jagajit Singh, Maharaja of Kapurthala, entrusted Cartier with the creation of a head ornament consisting of 19 exceptional emeralds, including an incredibly rare stone of 117.40 carats. Cartier has been a privileged witness of royal and princely love stories, such as that of the Duke and Duchess of Windsor, or that of Grace Kelly and Prince Rainier III of Monaco, who sealed their union with a Cartier ring adorned with a 10.47 carat emerald-cut diamond. For her wedding to Prince William in London on April 29, 2011, Catherine Middleton, future Duchess of Cambridge, wore a Cartier tiara. Created in 1936 for the Duchess of York and future Queen Elizabeth, the precious tiara was also worn by Princess Margaret in 1955. This headpiece with scroll motifs creates a halo of light, which has given it the name Halo Tiara. These rings, tiaras, and sets of jewelry are testament to an extraordinary dialogue between the jeweler and these historic personalities.
Okay. So Louis and Jaco continued to go to the opera, and they particularly enjoyed the performance of 1001 Nights with its bold, colorful costumes. And this is what got them started with the more colorful creations, where they mixed, green emeralds or jades with blue sapphires. It was unheard of before that. There was a fascination with Eastern culture in Paris at the time. There were Oriental themed balls. One man hosted a party for 3,000 guests, and they all came in their exotic costumes, dripping with jewels. Those people knew how to live. Okay, in 1910, Louis was in St. Petersburg for the annual Christmas bazaar, where two royal Russian princesses were supposed to be his sales assistants for 4 days. That should tell you the caliber of people who were going to be buying. But Cartier's competitors set him up, and customs officials barged into his hotel room a few days before and arrested him and confiscated his box loads of jewels. It was on trumped-up charges, and the idea was to detain him and to hold on to his jewels until after the bazaar had passed, so that he wouldn't be able to participate. And his biggest rival at the time, Carl Fabergé. Ironically, something similar had happened to Fabergé in London. I swear these jewelers, they're gangsters with tiaras. So the one bright spot from this was that it proved Cartier's mettle, because jealous or envious people only ever attack you when you are perceived as a threat to them. Louis had been personally invited by Grand Duchess Vladimir. There she is, a certified jewelry addict. Can you tell? She had so much jewelry that the fabulously wealthy Consuelo Vanderbilt was in stunned silence for almost 2 full minutes the first time she saw the Grand Duchess's jewelry collection. And so the Grand Duchess intervened, and Louis was able to participate in the bazaar. And within 4 days, he had sold $18 million worth of jewelry to Russian royals. Now he knew he'd really entered the inner circle. He also gave $300,000 to the poor in St. Petersburg. So what did he sell during the bazaar? He sold 13 tiaras, 19 necklaces, 90 brooches, and then a few pocket watches for the men. He stayed on in Russia and even had Jaco join him there. And they traveled all over with their sketchbooks. He actually really admired Fabergé, and he marveled at the Fabergé eggs. He even copied him sometimes. For example, in 1911, France gifted Tsar Nicholas II a Cartier Easter egg, modeled off of one of the Fabergé eggs. So Louis found it ironic that the wealthiest clients of luxury items always took the longest to pay him. Same challenge that Fabergé had had. So Louis met the love of his life, Jeanne Toussaint. Pan Pan. She was nicknamed Pan Pan because she loved panthers. But even though they lived together for a while, he knew that he could not marry her. She came from a poor background, and the class system was very strictly observed right back then, and would have been bad for business. So his family pressured him to break up with her, and he did. But he did employ her at Cartier. In 1919, Cartier began receiving royal patents from the royal families all over Europe, and he expanded. The company did very well. It did exceptionally well. But to me, one of the incidents in the Cartier story that really tells me they arrived is something that happened in 1916. So, a very spoilt young wife was married to a railroad baron, wanted a two-string Cartier pearl necklace. Her name was Macy Plant. Okay. And her 60-year-old husband loved to dote on her. This happened in New York City, by the way. So her husband knew how much she wanted the two-string pearl necklace. And so he asked Pierre Cartier to name his price. And Pierre Cartier asked for this Renaissance-style mansion in exchange for the pearl necklace. And he got it. Her husband agreed to it. In the meantime, Santos and the Wrights were still mastering the air. He built his last plane. Let me share a video about that.
Santos's triumph would last nearly a year before Louis Blériot, Henri Farman, and five other French aviators would make similar short flights. Meanwhile, back in America, the Wright brothers watched the French aviators in stunned disbelief.
It really hadn't occurred to them that people like Santos-Dumont and basically the rest of the French would be willing to do it in quite a different way and kind of stumble into the air in a machine that was essentially out of control the whole time it was in the air. It had simply not occurred to the Wrights that anybody would be willing to do it that way, to take that approach.
The Wrights' great accomplishment in flight was recognizing that flight wasn't simply a matter of getting off the ground with power and then staying in the air with lift. A lot of people overemphasize the notion of power and lift. The Wrights recognized the most important thing was control.
The Wright brothers achieved their control through a technique called wing warping. The pilot's control stick is connected to wires on the wingtips, allowing the pilot to twist or warp the end of the wings up or down, giving greater control during turns. August 8, 1908, the Wright brothers are ready to come out of the shadows. Their patent finally secure, the Wrights are prepared to show that they have the right stuff. And where did they do it? Santos's backyard, France. It is a short flight, but with Wilbur Wright at the controls, the Wright flyer shows complete mastery of the skies. The Wrights quickly become Parisian royalty. Santos is devastated.
It was, I may say now, rather a painful experience for me to see, after all my work in dirigibles and heavier-than-air machines, the ingratitude of those who, only a short time ago, covered me in praise.
When the Wrights came to Europe and demonstrated the Wright flyer, both in 1908 and 1909, they had a degree of control over the vehicle and a degree of mastery over the vehicle that was astonishing.
Ironically, the Wrights' mastery is very short-lived.
By 1909, the French are rushing right past the Wright brothers and everybody else. They've become, suddenly, the real leaders in world aviation.
Helping to lead the way, once again, is Santos-Dumont. After his huge disappointment at being upstaged by the Wrights, Santos goes back to his workshop. In 1909, a year after Wilbur's first public flight, Santos unveils a new airplane, a monoplane far more advanced than 14 Bis or the Wright Flyer. He calls it Demoiselle or Dragonfly.
One of the great qualities Santos had, unlike many early pioneers, is that he wasn't wedded to a single design configuration. Ironically, the great creators of flight, the Wright brothers, were so wedded to their particular design configuration that it actually hobbled their ability to transform their concept into a successful, marketable airplane. As late as 1915, you could still look at Wright airplanes and see within them that same attempt to hang on to the technology of their original 1903 machine.
So his response, as was the case with his little one-person airships, is to build an airplane that's different from the ones his French colleagues are building. It's smaller, it's lighter, and it's aimed at realizing the same dream that he had at the very turn of the century, and that is a personal sort of flying machine.
Actually, when one takes a look at the Demoiselle and how it flew and how well it flew, you realize we are looking at the predecessor of basically the modern small general aviation airplane.
In Demoiselle, Santos clocks the then extraordinary speed of 55.8 miles per hour. Far faster than anyone has ever flown before.
It is a great design because it was sort of the forerunner of what we were going to get.
Pilot and collector Dan Taylor has restored a non-flying replica of Demoiselle, part of the collection at the old Rhinebeck Aerodrome, a museum in New York State.
So I'm sitting on this little canvas seat. You'll notice that hands kind of like to rest on the wheels. Well, that's my braking action. Most of the pictures you'll see of Santos-Dumont flying the Demoiselle, he had leather gloves on. This was the brakes. You grabbed onto the wheel as you were rolling, hopefully to a stop. Pretty remarkable idea. Now to operate the rudder, Santos-Dumont had a little wheel in his left hand. And the idea being with this wheel is that you can turn the airplane. I have a stick in my right hand. This is for pitch. And what I would do is pull back on this stick to climb out, push forward to dive or to descend. Santos-Dumont had a leather flying jacket, or he would use his coveralls, but either way, he had a small pocket that was sewn into the back of his jacket. And the stick behind me would operate the wing warp because that pocket would catch on that stick. That's how you would bank the airplane.
Unlike most aeronautical pioneers, Santos refused to patent his more than 20 airship designs, giving them to the world as a gift.
Santos-Dumont looked toward the future. He wasn't into commercializing his aircraft. He wanted humanity to have a vehicle for the future, one that would give humanity means of traveling through the immensity of our planet Earth.
Santos did want to share this dream of his, of personal sort of aviation, the potential for anybody to fly. So he did make the plans widely available, something the other aviators didn't necessarily do.
In 1910, Santos sadly crashed his plane, it was the Demoiselle, and was very badly injured. He would never fly again. He was 36 years old, so he moved to the French countryside to recover, and he became a recluse. Then World War I broke out, and for the first time, aircraft were used in a war to facilitate killings, the very opposite of Santos's intention, and would ultimately lead to his undoing. As it was the first war ever fought with planes, Santos blamed himself. These planes and airships were his babies. He had dreamt of them facilitating world peace. He just couldn't handle it. He went in and out of sanatoriums for years trying to find peace. After the war, his family moved him back to Brazil, and shortly thereafter, a civil war broke out in Brazil. Again, airplanes were used. He actually saw a plane get shot out of the sky. And later on, he was in the lift going up or down some building. And he was heard muttering to himself, "What have I done? Brothers are killing brothers." He was so shaken, he returned to his room and he took his own life. He died July 23rd, 1932. He was 59 years old. In the winter of 1921, Louis was on a break from work, and he visited the seaside town of Beauvais, very fashionable with the upper crust. And he was attending dinner at Le Bar du Soleil, also owned by the person who owned Maxim's in Paris. and he found himself seated next to Jacqueline Almasi, which was a Hungarian countess. If you've seen the film The English Patient with Ralph Fiennes, her cousin was the inspiration for his character. Okay, so she was exactly Louis' type. And being that she was an aristocrat, she ticked all the right boxes. But she assured him that the only way she would have anything to do with him was if they got married. And so they got engaged in 1922, and married in 1924. His family was thrilled. But Louis had married into a bastion of historical snobbery that had remained intact after World War I. The aristocracy. The Blue Bloods had a saying about Louis and Jackie and of their union. Celui qui a les bijoux et a les quartiers, which means he has the jewels and she has the coat of arms. You know, the upper class people treated Louis Cartier and Coco Chanel like they were domestic servants. It's hard to believe, right? And even after he married this countess, yes, things changed a little bit because he was a member of the tribe now, but not that much. A few years after marriage, Maurice de Rothschild invited them to a party. They went to the party. He welcomed them. And then in the middle of the party, he approached Louis and asked him, "What are you doing here?" And barked orders at him, humiliated him, and then ordered him to leave. So Louis got his wife and left. He did it just to put him back in his place, to show him who he was. So his wife may have been titled, but the family had no money. But by all accounts, they were very, very happy together. Louis channeled his anger at the humiliation and at the way the other aristocrats treated him into making Maison Cartier make sure that it would come out on top. So the Cartier empire continued to expand. And it was a losing battle because, you know, no matter how hard he tried to impress high society and gain their validation, most of them thought of him as a shopkeeper and nothing more. He shouldn't have bothered. By 1925, French luxury goods were all the rage in New York City. Marjorie Merriweather Post. Was a very, very rich woman from America, a Cartier collector, and the original owner of Mar-a-Lago. And she remained a lifelong client until her death. Many exiled Russians sold their jewels to Cartier after the revolution, and Cartier sold them off to their American clients. It was all very hush-hush, done very quietly, because discretion was their watchword. Louis left his second wife, Jacqueline, briefly, and he even tried to divorce her because she may or may not have had an affair with King Alfonso III. They reconciled eventually. In the lead up to World War II, the Paris branch wasn't doing as well as before, and Louis was increasingly in the US courting rich and famous clients. He and Jackie settled in New York City, but Louis's health was failing. He passed away on July 23rd, 1942, with his wife and son at his bedside. A brilliant visionary whose legacy still lives on. A man who started using platinum on his jewelry before it was even a precious metal. He made Cartier what it was. And, you know, the family was so concerned about how the company would fare without him that his death was kept secret from those in Paris for 2 months. And when they found out, those working at the building in Paris said that the building felt desolate, as if it had lost its soul. Can we talk briefly about the watch itself before concluding? So, Louis' main objective in making the Santos was to create a watch that offered precision and minimalism, and yet there were many meaningful touches in it. So it was square with rounded edges, and now the outer borders were a nod to the streets of Paris at the time. Paris used to have very narrow streets, but there was a plague going on, and the streets were widened by the iconic architect Baron Haussmann to prevent the spread of disease. And then this inner section with the screws is based on a representation of the bottom, the base of the Eiffel Tower when viewed from above, viewed from the air. And the winding crown was seven-sided and set with a blue sapphire to create a link between watchmaker and jeweler. And then the Cartier signature was discreetly written at an angle. Let me see, I think it's in the next pic. So over there. That's the Cartier signature. You have to be looking to see it. The Cartier signature over there. So it's always discreetly written at an angle by the Roman numerals. And Roman numerals were chosen in black graphic to reinforce the Cartier signature clean lines. And though the original Santos was created in 1904, it has had multiple reinterpretations over the years. So now in conclusion, so Santos designed the first mass-produced plane, the Demoiselle. He inspired the creation of the first pilot's watch and is largely the reason why men's wristwatches are prevalent and normalized. He was instrumental to that, and we don't even know him. And it's very impressive what he did, especially when you compare him with Louis. Because remember, Louis Cartier had his brothers, he had his dad, and he had his grandfather. Everything Santos achieved, he did on his own. From his childhood dreams, he was a true dreamer. He kept on going despite failure, despite accidents, despite injuries for years. He gave everything. He sank his entire inheritance into creating airplanes. Look at all he achieved in one lifetime, and then challenge yourself. It's easy to see why they were such good friends. They both enjoyed creating. They dared to go where others feared. They were change makers. They lived fearlessly. They both came from money and they were heirs to great fortunes. They put everything into making their goals reality. Louis even entered an arranged marriage to help build the Cartier. And even after that marriage failed, he kept going. Santos risked his life and poured his soul into his dreams to make them reality. And when he saw how airplanes were being used to kill people, it destroyed him. He had such a good heart, and he gave everything to the world for free. And yet, most of the world has forgotten his name. Now, I want to end with this song that just kept coming up as I was reading the story of Santos-Dumont, because I think it's a wonderful tribute to him.
The unbeatable foe, to bear with unbearable sorrow, to run where the brave dare not go, to right the unrightable wrong, to love, pure and chaste from afar. To try when your arms are too weary to reach the unreachable star. This is my quest, to follow that star. No matter how hopeless, no matter how far, to fight for the right without question or pause. To be willing to march into hell for a heavenly cause. And I know, let my heart lie peaceful and calm when I'm laid to my rest. And the world will be better for this, that one man scorned and covered with scars, still strove with his last ounce of courage to fight the unbeatable foe, to reach the unreachable star.
Please do not let this man's story die. Remember his name. Alberto Santos-Dumont. Thank you.